Good day, everyone. Eddie Huff with you, along with Dave Van Rizium, or David Van, as he likes to be called. And we have a special guest and good friend with us this Saturday morning, or whatever time it is you're looking at us and listening to us. We have Nathan Dahm, State Senator. Yeah. Nathan Dahm. Haven't seen you in a while, Nathan. It's good to see you. I'm glad you dressed up for us, as I have. I dress up every, we all do, but you're right in with us. You know, I tell you, when you walked in, it warmed my heart because, my mind went back. We've known each other for a long time. I think it's probably been 20 years. I think you were a teenage kid the first time I met you.
I looked like it. I was still in my 20s, but I looked
Were
like
you
it.
In your 20s?
Yeah.
You were working for the city of Jenks back in those days, and you were this quiet little young, or I weren't little, but this quiet young kid, and impressive at that time. And since then, you've become a state senator, and now you're trying to move on up.
Yeah.
To the east side.
Yeah.
Yeah.
First time I met him, I was supposed to hate him.
You were supposed to hate him?
Oh, absolutely.
You're never supposed to hate anybody, Dave.
He was running.
You were supposed to sometimes.
Well, you were running the Ron Paul campaign over here in this side of the state. I was running Rick Santorum's campaign.
You were running it. I was just involved in Ron Paul.
Nobody was running.
I was not running anything.
In fact,
I was putting out yard signs.
Because, you know, I talked to Al Gerhardt, who was supposed to be, and he said there was no one person going to run that bunch, you know. But passionate bunch.
Yes.
Great bunch. And all of a sudden, we got, you know, past the primary, and we had this issue with the district convention that was kind of being robbed from us, and you and I had to work together. I found out you're a decent guy. I had to sit next to you.
This man
greatly influenced my politics over the last 10 years.
I didn't disappear like a lot of
That's
people
true.
Do. They get behind one candidate, their candidate doesn't win, and they just drop out.
Yep.
No, I'm in this for the long haul because I know that our country is at stake, and I believe that the Republican Party is the best path forward with that because if we followed the platform and the ideals of the Republican Party, we have a lot of rhinos that don't do that, but we had to work within the party to try to accomplish those things. And we have worked together
and we have
accomplished a lot of those goals that we first started out working on a decade ago or however long ago that was.
And you've learned how to pick your fights and choose which ones not to get distracted by.
So it's funny because I remember when you first ran for the, I guess you ran for the House of Representatives, the
US
Sullivan
House.
Seat the way back. And I remember I told you that I didn't think you were ready. Do you remember? Yeah. That's one thing about me. I can't keep my mouth shut.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. Well, I like to tell people
I appreciate about
that was, that's been what, 10 years ago? I think it may have been.
14, 15 years ago.
Wow.
2010.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Wow.
12 years. Yeah.
Time flies. Yeah. So, but, you know, and now you're back and you're taking a leap forward. So, you've had some experience since then and you've been in the state house. You were in, the state house. You've been in Senate. You were in House first, right?
No,
oh, you went straight to Senate and now
state Senate.
Staying and you've been term limited, I guess. This is it for you. So tell me this, Nathan. One thing I do have to ask, okay? And by the way, to make it clear, Nathan is running for U.S. Senate District 2. Is it one?
Well,
you don't have one and two in the Senate. That's right.
The unexpired term of senator in the position
that he currently has and he's resigning from.
That's right.
Yeah.
Let me ask you this, and because this is a question I think I've heard from a number of people. Mm-hmm. You initially had signed up to run against James Lankford. That was your original plan. What caused you then to switch to decide to run for the other one?
And that's a valid question. I've had people ask me that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a newlywed. My wife and I are coming up on 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
And so I always say when my wife and I were praying about it, we've been praying about it for 2 years. And people are like, well, wait a minute. We were praying about it while we were engaged, while we were dating. We wanted to know what direction God was going to take us. So we'd been praying about this for over a year and a half before we made the announcement, but close to 2 years we'd been praying about it. Mm-hmm. The whole time we were together, we were praying about, okay, God, what's next steps for us? Where are you going to take us? And as we prayed about it, we kept coming to that we were going to be on the ballot in 2022. That's the first mm-hmm. thing. We just believed we were supposed to be running for something. We're like, okay, God, well, what do you want us to run for? We kept coming back to U.S. Senate. And so we're like, okay, well, there's only one U.S. Senate seat available. But as we kept praying about it, we felt like there was going to be a special election. And so we're like, okay, God, if you want us to do that, that's fine. But you need to tell us the timing on when to step out for that. So we just kept praying about it. And we, in the summer, we were praying about it. And we kept getting September 28th, kept just coming to us. And as we were praying and everything, we just kept saying, coming back to September 28th. And we're like, okay, well, then if that's when we need to announce, we can announce that. But there's no special election. So we decided that we were going to announce for U.S. Senate. But one thing that we tried to make abundantly clear to everybody is that we were running for U.S. Senate, but we were not running against anyone in particular. Yes, I have some disagreements with Senator Lankford and some of his votes and different things. But whenever people would ask that, yeah, if they would ask specific differences between me and Senator Lankford, I would do that. I would compare that. But I always was telling them, no, we're running on our record for U.S. Senate. And then as soon as the announcement came about with Senator Inhofe announcing he was retiring and it's going to be a special election, we're like, okay, well, this is the answer to prayer that we've been waiting for. So that's why we made the move over immediately, because we had already prayed about it and felt like that's what it was going to be. But we also felt like we needed to step out when we did back in September. So we just felt like that was the direction God led us to. I know not everybody understands that or will agree with that. I know a lot of people in politics will blame God for all sorts of things or whatever, but that's just the process that my wife and I went through when we were going through this entire thing. So yeah, we originally announced back in September for U.S. Senate in the only seat that was open, but then once this other seat came open, we felt like that's the door we were supposed to step through.
Okay. One little housekeeping thing. Yeah. I'm going to need you, either pull it a little more to that side.
Like that.
Yeah, okay. There you go. Because we're losing you whenever you're looking at me.
Okay. He's going to make an eye contact.
Yeah, he is. Yeah. Actually, the eye contact you need to make is more over there.
This is a conversation.
But yeah, it's a conversation. So no, it's good. But I just want to be sure because you're dropping off. Okay, yeah, I wanted to get that out of the way and so that people at home would know, because I know the question has been out there, why did you do it because you thought it would be easier in an open seat like that versus going against an incumbent like James Lankford? We have not kept it a secret. We personally believe, at least I do, I don't know, I can't speak for David, but, let me say, I personally believe I would much rather see running against Lankford, because I think, like you, we definitely have some disagreements and questions, many, about James Lankford, although it seems he's a harder one to unseat at this point because he's got, for some reason, all these people on his side, which I still can't understand why he has all these people on his side other than all the Baptists.
It appears that way.
Yeah, it appears that way. He's got all these Baptists around the state on his side, people that went to his youth group, his youth camps and stuff like that. But the man, I mean, I know some personal things. I've seen some things, people he's met with, things he's been involved with and so forth. And you probably know as well that to me disqualify him immediately, but the public doesn't know that, and a lot of them don't really care, so we'll just let that go. I do not think that the person running against him stands a chance, although I think he would probably make a better senator. Personally, that's a personal opinion, but right now we're dealing with you, and we're dealing with the other Senate seat. What do you think Senator Inhofe has not done, has not pushed, has not supported, that you would like to see happen in the U.S. Senate?
One of the main things, I mean, and I'm not just saying this because it's popular, I think it's growing in popularity, though, is term limits. I mean, obviously, it's not something he's pushed. There's a lot of great things that Senator Inhofe did do, but term limits is not one of them because he's been up there for, 40 years or something. So I think that is one of the best things that did change the direction of the state of Oklahoma was when we implemented term limits here. And the thing that I tell people is I did sign the term limits pledge. I signed it the day that I announced. I fully support term limits. I know there's some people that are negative on term limits because you get rid of the good along with the bad. I can tell you, having been in the state legislature, there is a whole lot more bad that needs to be gotten rid of. And so overall, I think it's a net gain when you get new people up there. Sometimes you get bad people again. Sometimes you replace a good person with a bad person. It all happens, but I feel that mostly term limits are a positive thing. But the other thing about term limits, when we passed term limits back in the 90s here in the state of Oklahoma, we didn't just pass term limits for our state legislature and our statewide offices. We actually passed term limits for our federal delegation. In the Oklahoma Constitution, it says that we're supposed to have 3 terms for House members, 2 terms for senators. It is limited to that. Oklahoma wasn't the only state to do that. There was actually numerous states that did it, including our neighbor, Arkansas. And that law was challenged, went all the way up to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court struck it down, if you believe the Supreme Court can do that, but issued an opinion saying that the states cannot put term limits on their federal delegation. Totally incorrect, totally unfounded. The 10th Amendment says all powers not given to the federal government are reserved to the states. So if we in Oklahoma want to have term limits on our federal delegation, we can. Now, we can't put term limits on California's delegation or any of the, you know, any of the other states outside of our boundaries, but we can limit it. So that's still in our Oklahoma Constitution. I still think that needs to be followed. So I think term limits is one of the biggest things that, that needs to be addressed. And then a second thing that I would say that Senator Inhofe hasn't been as focused on is the out-of-control spending. I mean, Senator Coburn, there was a few things that he voted wrongly on and missed on, but he was very good at being a fiscal hawk and focusing on that stuff. I mean, we're $30-plus trillion in debt now. You know, it's unsustainable. It's immoral. I can go down the list. You all know my background living overseas in Romania. I saw massive inflation. I try not to downgrade or belittle the 7% inflation we're experiencing right now, the 7% that they're claiming we're experiencing, because it's hurting everybody.
It is.
But I've seen how much worse it can get, and it's because of the spending, and it's because Republicans have done it too. It's not just the Democrats that have spent us into oblivion in D.C. It's Republicans.
If I can say it, on term limits, is there not also an argument can be made constitutionally that you are limiting the choices of the people and in some ways theoretically harming Democratic freedom of people to choose who they want?
Yes. I mean, you can make the case, and people say that, you know, well, the ballot box is the term limit because you can actually vote people out and do that.
But the reality is when you're entrenched, you're entrenched, and we even see Mullen and Hearn doing this, using their congressional office funds for essentially campaigning.
To campaign, yeah.
And that ought to be stricken down there.
Here's the problem I have. I'm like you, what you're saying. I believe we have term limits, and those are, they're called elections.
Yes.
If the people don't want you, they get rid of you. I believe we should have better, maybe, what would you say, election rules or better information systems or whatever, to let the people be better informed.
Right,
exactly. I think that would be better, to that way people can make more intelligent decisions. That would be a better form of term limits. Because, for example, okay, you right now have the support of Rand Paul. You have the support of what's his name? My mind slipped from Texas.
I'm not sure.
Yeah.
The senator from Texas.
Ted Cruz. Not yet.
Okay, I'm pretty sure. I think he's been in your camp, you know. So let's say, but these guys, they've been there forever, and they're going to stay there as long as they can, okay?
Cruz has been 10 years.
Yeah. So to say I'm for term limits, but these guys have been there forever, you know, Jim Inhofe has been there for probably since I was born.
Mid-80s he's been in Washington.
No, probably since you were born at least, so let's just put it that way.
Before you were born.
So I know that kind of galls us a bit, but at the same time, the people of Oklahoma chose Jim Inhofe. He's had many people run against him, and thank goodness he's been there against some of the people who have run against him, okay? So there have been good and bad times. Let's say I don't know of anybody yet that I can think of that might have been better than him that has run against him. So I personally, I understand your thinking. I agree with the thinking behind it. But at the same time, constitutionally, if we're going to speak constitutionally, the Constitution has put in already the guideline for elections. And that is every 6 years you vote for a senator, every 2 years for a representative. Okay. Every time we start tinkering with the Constitution, somehow bad results happen.
Do you think?
I think, yeah.
17th Amendment. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. 16th Amendment.
Yeah. And you take what one thing we've been discussing for how many weeks, probably convention of states.
Yeah. Oh, five. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You, which scares the heck out of me.
You've done your research on, you actually went to a mock convention, mm-hmm. didn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. The balanced budget one in Arizona.
Right.
They sent me because they knew that I was opposed to it and they wanted somebody on the other side.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. And so to me, it's another thing that, you know, you're opening Pandora's box. So that's the only reason. I think that if you're the best candidate somehow, and praise God, you told us, why don't you tell us quickly, you just received a call on the way here that you received.
He didn't receive. He heard.
Well, he heard.
He can't be involved in it.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, yeah, there's no coordination. I was notified after the fact. Well, I saw a reporter reported on it, so that's how I found out about it. Yeah.
Okay. What did you hear?
I'll tell you that, but then I got to get back to the term limits thing.
Okay, yeah, good.
So I heard that I believe it's called the Protect Freedom PAC, which mm-hmm. is one, a Rand Paul supported PAC is doing an ad buy media purchase. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's TV, radio. They have to report how much they're spending, and if it's in support or opposition, that's all they report. That's what I saw a reporter said. Okay, mm-hmm. they just reported this, that they're spending $35,000 mm-hmm. in support of our campaign for the next 2 months till mm-hmm. the election day. So that's huge.
That is huge.
You got to have skin in the game. I think Inhofe used to say, no money, no message, no message, no victory.
Yeah. Right? Exactly.
Exactly. Exactly.
Okay. But I got to get back on that.
Yes. Okay. No, I just wanted to say that. But that's good news because it shows that you have support.
Yes.
And you need that. Mm-hmm. I always, what used to kill me is when I asked these people talk about, yeah, I'm supporting so and so and we're, and, well, how much have you given? Yeah. Well, in kind. You know, the in kind. Yeah. And that's
all. Oh, yard sign.
Yeah, you're not.
Which costs money. They didn't donate.
Yeah. So I'm not
complaining about that. If people want yard signs, we'll give you a yard sign. Yeah. If you want to cover the cost of it, we'll take that too. Yeah. But and I know you want to talk about this with Rand Paul.
Term limits.
Well, wait, let me say something else, because I'm going to tee it up for him and then I'll come back to term limits.
Okay.
With Senator Paul, I mean, I've been in the state Senate and I know what it's been like to be the lone voice mm-hmm. of reason of the Constitution, you know, mm-hmm. in the wilderness, but I also know what it's like to have backup and support and stuff.
Yeah.
So that's one reason why they've become so involved in our campaign, because they know that it won't be on him carrying the weight.
Exactly.
I've seen that at the state Senate level, and you kind of want to probably talk about that, but on the term limits thing, yes, I agree with what you're saying. I know that it's ultimately up to the people to decide who they want to vote, and so term limits does limit them. But we did do an amendment to the Constitution to limit the president. We have term limits in there. Mm-hmm. We changed that because we got away from the original intent of the Constitution. Mm-hmm. The original intent was that you have citizen legislators. You have people that come up there and serve for a time period, a limited time period, and then they return back to whatever their business is. Mm-hmm. Whether they were a farmer, a rancher, a lawyer, in the founding era, that's what they did. They served for a time period. It was like serving their community. I mean, that's what they looked at it as. Mm-hmm. We've gotten away from that. Same thing happened with the presidency. You know, President Washington served 2 terms and then he stepped out. There was not term limits on him forcing him to do
right.
that. He set that standard and everyone else followed that. Until FDR. Mm-hmm. And then we got away from the Constitution, away from the original intent anyways. Mm-hmm. And so they were like, okay, well then, since we've lost our foundation really in a lot of ways, we need to put it in writing and put it in there and say, okay, just 2 terms for the presidency. Mm-hmm. I feel like the same thing. Yeah. If we had just a bunch of citizen legislators, a lot of people that would just go up there and self-term limit and actually keep their word, we wouldn't need to do that. Mm-hmm. And maybe it is the type of thing where some people do need to be up there for 20 years. Because they're going to continue to fight and serve. But I don't think that. I think that the majority of people, if you had the people with the right heart, with the right mentality, right understanding of the Constitution, you wouldn't need term limits. unfortunately, we've fallen so far away from our soul as a society, as a country, that we have to put these things in writing. Yeah. So that's where I'm at on it. That's my perception.
Sure. No. And I'm with you.
And we can have different opinions.
No, and I like that. And I like to hear that. I like the argument because it's a legitimate argument. And it's especially legitimate when you have people like Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi. But, yeah. I mean, here's my fear that you're going to get the next generation that is even worse than Schumer, you're going to get AOC. You know, you're going to replace the Schumers with the AOCs, which are
only be there for a shorter time period instead of being there for forever.
And then you get a AOC squared,
because if Schumer dies or retires, AOC is going to be the next U.S. Senator from New York.
Yes.
And then she will be there for 40 years with all of her nonsense.
Right.
But if we had term limits, she couldn't be. So
that's true. Okay. Thank you.
He said something that reminded me of something classic when he says, okay, I'll answer you this, but then I got to get back to this and then that was when he told a pretty well-known anchor with CNN. Now I could answer that question or the question you asked before that or the question you asked. I'm talking about Piers Morgan.
Yeah.
Because you had the famous Piers Morgan handgun legislation. Yes. And I said, man, you better get to see him before he gets fired because he was already on the downside. Yeah. And he took the bait. And I'm telling you, folks, if you ever want something that will encourage you when you're dealing with the leftist media, pull up on YouTube, just search Piers Morgan, Nathan Dahm. It was a masterpiece, and I'm saying that because our former president, Donald Trump, just mixed it up with him, and I don't think Trump did as well.
He should have watched your video.
Talk about what your strategy was there.
Well, I have to give President Trump some credit, okay?
Okay.
So, well, let me, I'll get to that as I tell the story. I'll try and go through the story quickly. I'd finished my first year up in the state Senate and I was frustrated because we had Republican supermajority control of the legislature and we weren't doing anything conservative. Mm-hmm. We couldn't even get a single Second Amendment bill heard in committee because the Republican chairman of that committee was anti-Second Amendment.
Yeah.
With Republican supermajorities. It was just blowing my mind. And so went through a first year. I was frustrated that nothing was getting done. So I wanted to bring some attention to the issue. So I filed a permitless open carry bill, constitutional carry light, and I decided to name it the Piers Morgan Constitutional Right to Keep and Bear Arms Without Infringement Act.
Yeah.
Because he was on CNN and he was berating the Second Amendment all the time.
He took the bait.
One of the local news stations, I think one of the OKC ones, tweeted out at him and said, did you see this Piers Morgan Act? And he was just appalled, that somebody would do such a thing.
Using his name.
Yeah. He took the bait, challenged me to come on his show. This was this was middle of the week, like Wednesday or Thursday. Yeah. One of his producers, I said, have your producer contact me. I'll come on. His tweet was, at Nathan Dahm, come on my show and debate your Piers Morgan Act if you have the guts.
Yeah.
That's not something you should say to me. just letting you know. Okay. And so I said, absolutely, have your producer contact me. So we worked it out for the next Monday. And they said, we'll find a studio in Tulsa with a satellite uplink. You can just do it remotely by satellite and everything. I was like, okay, fine. Agreed to it so that we could get it booked. And then about 2 hours later, I emailed back and I said, hey, by the way, I'm still willing to do remote uplink, but I'd come in studio if that's an option. And they were like, yeah, that'd be even better. We'll get it all worked out. And I wanted to do the interview either way, but I've seen enough clips of CNN on YouTube and stuff that they have that weird glitch in their system that every time the conservative is winning the argument, they lose the satellite feed.
Yeah.
So I knew they were going to try and do that to me if I didn't go in person. So I agreed to go in person. And so went to his studio in New York. He had a studio in New York and in LA, but he was at the New York studio. So we went up to New York and, right before the interview started, I said to him, I asked him, I said, and I don't remember the guy's name now, but I said, is John still your producer? Your executive producer? And he's like, oh, you know John? And I said, oh, no. I've just been reading a lot about him in your book lately. Mm. I bought his book that weekend, but I always tell people I bought it on sale and I used a coupon. Mm-hmm. So I bought it as cheap as possible. But it was a tactic that I learned from President Trump. So when Larry King was leaving CNN before Piers Morgan took over, he was doing his farewell stuff and he was having in a bunch of people. and he had in Donald Trump. This was before he was President Trump, obviously, but he had in Donald Trump. And Trump asked him, he said, Larry, do you remember our very first interview? And Larry said, of course, how could I forget it? He's like, do you remember what happened right beforehand? He's like, yes. Right before we started, you leaned into me and you said, Larry, I don't know if anybody's ever told you this before because you're such a big name in news, but you have terrible breath for a broadcaster. And Larry King was just like shocked. And if you watch the interview,
yeah,
the whole time Larry King's just kind of like, he's kind of fidgeting. He's just kind of like,
Oh my goodness.
He was on his heels. President Trump.
Trump did that to him.
On purpose to put him on his heels, right?
Yeah.
And so I remember seeing that Trump had did that. So that was my attempt to do that to Piers Morgan, was letting him know that I had read his whole book.
Yeah.
And that I knew who his producer was that was going to be in his ear the entire interview and stuff. And so, I have to give President Trump credit for that.
Nice.
But I also do say that I went after the fake news before it was popular.
Because right.
Before President Trump coined that phrase, I was willing to go into the lion's den. That was actually only my second live TV interview that I'd ever done. I'd done one live one before that. I'd only been in office for a year and had done one with a local station before that. But yeah, I had a lot of fun with it, and I definitely feel like I won the debate. And yeah, at one point in time, like you mentioned, he was just – one of his tactics was just – throwing question after question, and you know, and so I just called him out on it.
And he got fired shortly after that.
Yeah, I always mention it's kind of bittersweet that he got fired because I had enough material to go there and beat him at least three more times. So I didn't even use my best stuff on that first one. I kind of wish I would have.
Oh my goodness!
But I had, because I had stuff from his book and other things that I was prepared, and I had no idea how long they were going to have me on. They had me on for two segments, so I think it was like 15 minutes total or something. We did go to a commercial break during it, and he wouldn't even talk to me. He wouldn't look up. He wouldn't do anything. If you look Google it and watch the video, you'll see that he had all his index cards in front of him. I didn't have anything because I just prepared and I was going off memory.
Yeah.
And since he wouldn't talk to me during the break, I just decided to read all his notes.
Yeah.
I don't know what happened during the second one, but yeah. So it was fun. That was a fun experience.
Yeah. So let's segue into this permitless carry because I know you've been working on it for years. It's a landmark legislation on constitutional rights. Then this year, landmark legislation on right to life. And you're the author of that as well. Talk about your accomplishments in the Oklahoma Senate.
That's a great question, because I know one of the critiques of me that people will say is that, well, you know, Nathan doesn't play the game, so he can't get anything done. Well, that's not true.
And by the way, you got to tell how you got your first Senate leadership appointment, too.
I never had an appointment. I was elected. The committee
but
chair.
But the threat you made about the trouble you could cause.
Yeah, there was one point, at one point in time early on when I was up at the Senate, one of the Senate leaders was walking by, and I said to the other person that I was talking to, loud enough that the other senator could hear it, I said, you know, one thing about me is that they have nothing that they can take away from me. So I have nothing to lose.
Yeah.
And this member of Senate leadership stopped, came back over and said, what'd you say? And I said, they have nothing to take away from me. So I have nothing to lose. Mm-hmm. And I said, that makes me a very dangerous man.
Yeah.
And he's like, interesting. So they did at one point in time, they gave me a chairmanship. It was
general government.
It was.
Yeah. It's not the most powerful committee
or anything. Thinking that that would, you know, tamper me down
keep you busy.
That actually was their main intent, was to keep me busy. And it didn't keep me busy enough because I continued to focus on protecting individual rights and everything. Mm-hmm. Now, eventually they did take that away from me, that chairmanship, because I voted against all the tax increases. Mm-hmm. But I told them from the beginning, I'm not up there to be a chairman. Mm-hmm. So just because you now have something to take away from me doesn't mean I'm going to change.
And then they've made you a whip, right?
I was elected, as one of our whips. That used to be voted on by the caucus.
Yeah.
And so you have to get a majority vote of the caucus. And because I was proficient in what I would do, I was elected as one of our whips. There was actually four different whips that we would all serve together. And so we'd each have 1/4 of the caucus that we were kind of responsible for. But generally they would just have me go to every member of the caucus and find out where they were on certain bills, because I could do it faster for all four of us than just splitting it up. So they would have me do a lot of that. And because of that, I was in the leadership meetings.
Mm-hmm.
So I would always be the voice of conservatism when they were pushing for tax increases or everything else.
Yeah.
I would counter that with the constitutional and conservative perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So eventually they changed it to where all the whip positions are now appointed.
Right.
So that they could get me out of the room.
Fact is, I think you said after a caucus meeting, treat basically change the rules without even a vote of his caucus.
No, we did vote on it, but they interpreted a rule a certain way to where they got fair
claim. By the way,
asked, and okay. it was just that insider nonsense they do.
I'm going to get back to the permitless carry. Mm-hmm. I think at least one, if not more, states have gone to that since as well, right?
The majority of the states.
A whole bunch.
Oh, have
actually
they?
26 now, for sure 25, mm-hmm. but I think 26 states, because several of them passed it this year. Oklahoma was, we ended up being number 15, I believe. We could have been number 12, but Fallon vetoed it, mm-hmm. so we had to come back, and then we passed it again, and Governor Stitt signed it. So I think we were 15 or 16, and since then, yeah, another 10 have passed it. So.
Right. It was the first bill Stitt signed.
Yes, it was the very first bill
that Governor Stitt signed. As new governor.
Yeah. Yeah, which is, now, I still carry my, I still get my, especially, I mean, it helps if you go into a state that right. still yeah. needs it.
There are good
and
reasons. So
and I'll tell you, I told a story, I got stopped in Owasso by the police, and it's amazing when they see that, if you just get a speeding ticket and you hand them that, it's weird. All of a sudden it changes their attitude towards you. You know, it's like all of a sudden you gain respect from them.
I've heard that from other law enforcement officers.
Yeah. They say, oh, wow. Hey, you know, and mm-hmm. so it really does help. So, for those of you that don't have your concealed carry or have thought about it and wondered, it's kind of worth it a little bit.
Yeah, especially if you travel. I still get mine, even though I pass constitutional carry, so that I can have it whenever I'm traveling.
Right.
But I don't believe that you should have to pay the government to exercise
constitutionally
protected right.
Exactly.
So that's why I pushed for it for so long.
Okay, I want to ask you about another bill. I just read last night, Tennessee just made ivermectin an over-the-counter drug. You wrote such legislation. What happened to it?
The chairman refused to hear it.
Right.
The Republican chairman refused to even give the bill a hearing.
Now, I can go buy it for my dog over-the-counter.
Yes.
Which is more dangerous because it doesn't have the safety protections, the level of, you know, purity and inspections and, you know,
correct,
potency. Yes. But I can still buy that, but I can't buy it for myself.
Well, you can, but you have to go to the feed store.
Yeah.
Right.
Which is what people are doing. You know, I bought some there. That's where I get my ivermectin. Yeah.
Now, there were like three bills, I think, written. Yours was one of them, was killed. But so this is still a problem this year.
Yeah. It's, I mean, Republicans still have control, but conservatives don't have the control, and that's the difference.
Let me, because I don't want to get into, he's running for the U.S. Senate, so yeah. I want to keep the conversation.
Yeah,
that's fine, but I don't mind answering some of
the questions. Oh, no, I know, but for the sake of our people that are watching, because right now we're focused on you wanting to become a U.S. senator and not Oklahoma state senator.
Can I say one thing about him, and then if you have a question?
Sure.
So, because he had asked about some of my accomplishments.
Right.
Okay, in this,
right.
And I feel like it ties together because I'm running on my record.
Exactly.
Right? I mean, all the candidates will say, I mean, it's a Republican primary in Oklahoma. They're all going to say they're pro-life, pro-Second Amendment, for lowering taxes, they're all going to say all those things, right? So since I've been in the state Senate, I have passed over 100 bills, 100 laws. Now I've repealed over 200 laws.
Nobody talks about that.
I've eliminated two state agencies, so I have done those things. I can give examples of just common sense things that I did. Like when I was made the chairman of the General Government Committee, I went through and I read all of Title 11 because that deals with cities. Cities and towns. Title 19 deals with counties. That's what I had jurisdiction over, as all the bills dealing with those were going to come to my committee.
So rules, right?
Yes. So I read all of those titles of law and found a lot of different things that needed to be removed or whatever. But one of the main ones, we still had in our county statutes, Title 19, that all county documents had to be microfilmed. So I called one of my county guys and I said, please tell me you're not still microfilming things. And he said, oh, no, we're not microfilming it. We scan it. Then we send it to another company that converts it to microfilm and sends it back to us. And then we just put it in the storage depot. And they paid this company to do it because state law said that they had to microfilm everything. So I'm like, well, that's just stupid.
Yeah.
So I ran the bill to remove that and just say you have to keep it stored in whatever the modern technology of the day is. Which has saved counties millions of dollars.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there's common sense things like that I've done. But, yes, I passed the constitutional carry bill that Governor Fallon vetoed. Then we came back and passed it again. I passed the nation's first ever anti-red flag law. I passed over a dozen Second Amendment-related bills. My very first one was just legalizing pocket knives. because in our state statutes, it said that it was illegal to have a pocket knife that had any spring-type tension. So the pocket knives that you
switchblade.
Well, switchblade blades was specifically mentioned, but no, if you just have like a little tension lock on it,
right? Oh,
that was illegal. Okay. Uh-huh. And so, I mean, there were simple ones like that, but I can give you examples of all. I've done stuff with human trafficking.
Yeah, like this is my Leatherman snaps open. That's a spring.
That's illegal. On it. That was until I passed that very first bill. Okay. And so, I mean, some of them were common sense things, small measures. That was my first bill that I got.
Thank you for help that. Lead me out of a life of crime. So
you've already been down that path well before, David. No. But so, I mean, there's like a lot of those things that I can point to. Like I said, I've done stuff on human trafficking to address that. One bill that we did last year that was just another common sense measure. Right now, you know, there's the tax commission gives you a 1 month grace period if your tag expires, right? But cities were not, so they were still ticketing you, even though there was a one. So we just changed that to say, no, there's a 1 month grace period that you can't get ticketed either. So just some common sense measures like that too. But definitely, I mean, I can give you a lot of examples of fighting for individual rights.
Can I segue to national? Because this has to do with McGirt. All right. Now, we know that they've argued again before the Supreme Court. We'd like the Supreme Court to fix the problem they made, assuming they don't. What pledge can you give us that you and
quickly, because there may be people that don't know what you're talking about.
All right.
When you say McGirt, what are we?
I'll let him explain.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
So the McGirt decision, from the Supreme Court, there was a gentleman named McGirt who had, raped a young girl. I mean, I think she was under five, and other heinous crimes and different things. He was charged in Oklahoma State Court, found guilty, convicted, imprisoned. He went through the appeal process, and his lawyers went to the federal courts all the way up to the Supreme Court and challenged it and said that that this should have been done under federal jurisdiction because of the connection to Native Americans.
Reservation.
The reservations, because of the tribal thing. And so the Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, said that, well, yeah, they said that the reservations were never disestablished here in the state of Oklahoma. Mm-hmm. And I've actually read the McGirt decision. I read it. It was Gorsuch, and he got so many things wrong. Here's one example of what he said is he said, well, the reservations in Oklahoma were never officially called reservations. Mm-hmm. But if we look at other reservations of the time and other things and everything, they had like the same intent and same meaning. So they were reservations. Mm-hmm. And then later on in the opinion, he says, well, the state of Oklahoma makes the case that they never were reservations, and so it should be disestablished. But we have to go on the exact text of what was done. And since it was never officially disestablished by text, therefore we can't interpret it to that it was. So wait a minute. So you can interpret it to say it was a reservation, but you can't interpret it to say that the reservation was disestablished. I mean, he contradicts himself in so many different areas throughout the decision. But what it means for us here in Oklahoma is that pretty much the entire eastern half of the state, including parts of Tulsa County, half of Tulsa County, now there's a question of jurisdiction. So for almost any crime or criminal activity that happens here in the state of Oklahoma, we've had to get all of our law enforcement officers cross-deputized, because if anyone involved potentially has Native American ancestry, whether it's the victim or the perpetrator, it now has to go either to federal courts or it has to go to the tribal courts to be prosecuted, whether it's a fender bender, somebody breaks into your car and steals something out of it, all the way up to rape and murder, all those things now have to go through that. So, yes, there's a new case before the Supreme Court. There's a possibility that they could clarify or overturn the previous opinion. If not, in the McGirt decision, one thing that Gorsuch said is that Congress can correct this if they choose to. And so that would require someone that is willing to file legislation to clarify this, whether that be to say that, no, it never was a reservation, or upon being a part of statehood, it was disestablished. And so we will have to file some sort of legislation. I have been willing to talk with all sides and see what that would look like and how we can do that. I don't have language drafted yet. I am working on that to find out exactly what language, you know, I could do. But the main thing that I try and tell people too is if you look at the history of Oklahoma, of statehood, there actually was a movement that the tribes were trying to push for before we became a state.
Yes.
And they were trying to create the state of Sequoia, which was the east, in 1906. not 2006, 1906, they were trying to create the state of Sequoia because they knew that there was going to be a change in jurisdiction and only the previous congressional acts had passed. And so, they actually went to Congress. They tried to get it passed. It couldn't. They said, no, but what we will do is we'll let the eastern half and the western half of the state come together and become the state of Oklahoma. So they were already trying to become a state. Okay.
It's only because they failed in their first effort.
Yes. Yeah. And so to make the claim that they were going to become a state and then still keep their entire tribal jurisdiction and that so that there would be no state jurisdiction, it doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. How can you be a state and then still have fully tribal jurisdiction within that? Mm-hmm. There would be no point in having a state if you were going to continue to do that. So, they understood that they were going to be giving up jurisdiction to become a part of the state of Sequoia or the state of Oklahoma.
Okay, so you're willing to sponsor federal legislation, if elected, that would fix this problem?
Yes, yes, okay. Absolutely.
All right, so right now, what do you think, Nathan, is the most important thing the Senate can do or should do coming up in the next term?
Okay, so this is just me getting into the procedural side of things.
Right.
But outside of term limits, I think the main thing we could do
is
a single subject rule. If we could get either, I would prefer it to be in law.
Yeah, Oklahoma already.
Oklahoma has it in our constitution, but we could put it in federal statute. But if we could get a single subject rule passed, either in the rules in the Senate or the House, or in statute, actually in federal law, that would limit these 4,000, 5,000 page bills that they put on all their poison pill amendments and, you know, all their pork and everything. If we could just limit it to one thing, I think that is the number one thing that we could do that would totally change the direction of the country.
What do you think the odds of actually getting something like that passed would be? I mean, that seems like a high mountain to climb there, because as you said, you had a hard time, or we've had a hard time getting Republicans to play ball in Oklahoma. You're talking about trying to get it done in Washington. That seems like a really steep hill.
We've had a hard time getting things done, but I've gotten them done.
Yeah, well, that's true.
Constitutional carry done, Senate Bill 612, the, you know, felony conviction on abortions. I mean, I could tell you about something that happened this week that I was able to get some stuff done. If you know the rules, you can get stuff done even when they operate under their own understood rules. I mean, because that's the thing is they have the written rules and then they have the way that they operate. And so, but if you actually know the rules, you can get things done. Yeah, it takes time, but, and I'll be honest, I would be willing to put an amendment on one of the big omnibus, you know, one of their big pork barrel bills, you know, that says that from now on we do a single subject rule and attach that to it. And then, okay, so it's, we.
So they can attach whatever they want, yeah, but it's not.
We pass one more of these big, huge things with all their amendments, but one of the amendments is single subject rule, because then going forward, they can't do it. So you use their own tactics against them. So there are ways it can be done. Yeah, I'm not saying I'm going to get it done right away. It took me 5 years to get constitutional carry passed, but I was able to get it done. I'm not going to promise anything other than I'm going to fight for it. Right. But yeah, you can get things done if you know the rules, especially in the U.S. Senate, and you can stop things too. That's one All thing. Right. An individual can stop a lot.
Let me ask you, something that's been, in the news a lot, where it's, to me, it's prima facie. I mean, it's like right in your face, and that is Ukraine. Mm-hmm. Now, you are close to Ukraine because you spent part of your life in Romania, a neighboring state. I mean, you're right there. You probably used to go to Ukraine. I don't know.
If we never did. I didn't make it to Ukraine, but yeah, I mean.
Right now is working with Ukrainian refugees,
correct.
Right?
Yes, they're about 4 hours from the border, and so they're helping a lot of the refugees.
What is your thought? Because we have ours. I don't know if you've listened to our podcast in the past, but we have our opinions. We've been discussing it weekly almost on our opinions on what America's role, our involvement should be. Mm-hmm. What is your opinion on our involvement, what we should be doing? What do you think?
Yes. So on that, when you say America, that's where you have to differentiate. So I always say,
exactly,
depending on the government's role or the people's role. And,
okay.
And whenever we talk about the whole situation, because I like to clarify that also, when you talk about Russia and Ukraine, we have to realize that the Ukrainian people and the Russian people are in some ways just puppets. I mean, they're being manipulated. They're being forced to do things by their government, right?
So you're saying both, each one is being manipulated by their government.
Yes. I mean, you know, okay. I mean, there's Russians that don't want to be going to war in Ukraine, right? There's Ukrainians that probably don't support the current administration in the Ukraine and some of the things that they're doing. And so we have to realize that the people are separate from the government, right? So the actions even of the United States, a lot of times we, the people of America, get blamed for it, even if we disagree with it. Another perfect example, China. The people of China are wonderful. Their government is terrible, right? So, you know, we have to, I always like to, you know, differentiate between the government and the people. And so with the Russian and the Ukrainian governments, I will tell you that they are both extremely corrupt. I mean, over in Romania, the corruption is so rampant that they literally passed a law putting a cap or a threshold on when they would start actually trying people for taking bribery. And I think the cap was, if I remember correctly, about 100,000 euro. So you could take like up to 100,000 euro of bribes and not be prosecuted. It was if you went over that amount, because everyone over there is on the take. Their mayors steal from the road funds, their county. I mean, everyone takes money. They take bribes. They steal from, you know, the stuff. So, Eastern Europe is a very, very corrupt system. And so the Ukrainian government is extremely corrupt. The Russian government is extremely corrupt. So I don't trust the governments of either of those. Now, that's not in any way excusing Putin's actions of invading a sovereign country. No, he's absolutely wrong in that. And so I think as the American government, I am okay with our government sending supplies, even military supplies, over there. Now, I would prefer, I mean, there's enough of our defense contractors that produce enough stuff that they could just sell it themselves without the government having to be involved. So I would prefer that it just be done that way. But as far as American citizens, people can go and offer their support. Like you mentioned, my family is over there in Romania serving as missionaries, helping the refugees right now. I do not agree with committing any U.S. troops anywhere, whether it's Ukraine or anyone else, without a congressional declaration of war. The Constitution requires it. The president can't just send our men and women, our citizens, over to fight in a war without congressional declaration of war. So I've been very vocal and very opposed to any sort of troops on the ground, American troops on the ground in the Ukraine. If somebody wants to volunteer, and there have been some people to go do that, go do that. That's fine. But no, the president cannot and should not send troops over there. And even if there was a declaration of war, Washington warned about entangling alliances. Now, that doesn't mean all alliances, but he did warn about some entangling alliances and some of that stuff. So I would think very hard, long and hard, before I voted yes on any conflict, any war. And my policy was always, I would not vote yes for a war unless I was personally willing to go and fight it myself.
Wow.
I don't have any children yet, or send my children.
Right.
That's my policy.
You know, I'm sure you've heard Dwight Eisenhower's speech, that farewell speech on the military-industrial complex.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
You talk about prophetic. I mean, it's an amazing speech. And what I've seen is nothing but, I mean, that's who's getting the money. I mean, right now, that's what's happening. Mm-hmm. In America, the average American citizen is in the dark. Mm-hmm. They don't even know these billion. All we hear, $33 billion has been approved by the administration for Ukraine. Next week, another $500 billion. This next week, I mean, I think we're at probably, $3 billion, or is it 30-some billion? I don't know.
Yeah. Or military aid. And,
military aid that we've sent.
They're asking for more. Biden's pushing for more.
Do we even know what's happening? Is anyone following up on what's happening with this money?
No, that's where the corruption, and I'm sure there's corruption here in America that takes place. We know that, we can get into all that stuff. But the other thing, there's another good thing. I mean, you mentioned Dwight Eisenhower's, you know, talking about the military industrial complex. There was a general, I think his name was Smodley Butler. He wrote a pamphlet called War is a Racket. And I don't remember if it was after, I think it was after World War One, but he was like a high ranking general. He might have even been like a Medal of Honor winner or something. I mean, he was very well regarded, very well honored, and had a lot of meritorious duty things. So I encourage people, just search that, just War is a Racket. And he'll talk about how much of a racket it is. Because if you think about it, most of the product that is created during war is one-time use. I mean, whether it's ammunition, whether it's bombs, even a lot of, the planes and some of that stuff, you can use multiple times or some of that stuff. But then afterwards, a lot of it just gets decommissioned or, you know, or it's just used during that time period. So there's a lot of money that is made in wars just on that profit side, let alone without the corruption and everything else. So I always tell people, search that sometime if you want a good read. It's not very long, but he gives examples. Like, I think that there was, some specific, like, giant wrenches that were needed for something with Niagara Falls or something. And so they charged astronomical amounts. And he talks about, the boots that were ordered for the troops that in the winter that didn't arrive until the next summer. Mm-hmm. Somebody still got paid for them, but they were never used. And so he gives different examples of how war is a racket. And that's why the founding fathers were so weary of war. I mean, they just been through one. And the other thing that I always like to mention on this is that, America has not really won a war since we stopped following the constitutional required declaration of war.
Hmm.
I mean, we won World War II, but Korea was and still is a stalemate. Mm-hmm. Vietnam, we ended up withdrawing from and essentially losing. We declared victory, but we pretty much lost that. I mean, the Gulf War won. It was a stalemate eventually because we went back and we're still in Iraq all these years later. You could try and claim that as a victory, but Afghanistan, I mean, if you just look through all these things that we've been through, we really haven't won any of these conflicts ever since they started calling them conflicts.
Yeah, it depends how you define victory. And that's the problem is it quickly morphs into nation building.
And if you declare war, then you have to operate under the rules of war, and then you have to declare victory and actually sign a peace treaty and actually have that victory under specific parameters. Because otherwise, like you said, yeah, they can declare a victory on a conflict, but it's nation building, it's these other things because they're not following the rules of war and then declaring a peace because they haven't actually followed the Constitution and declared war.
Yeah.
So,
Nathan, I'm going to give you the next 5 minutes or so or whatever it takes to just state your case, and if you want to speak to the camera, whatever you want to do, just state your case on why you feel you should become the next senator for the state of Oklahoma.
Okay, yeah, okay. I appreciate that.
Please.
So the main thing that I tell people is, we mentioned it some already during this interview, is I'm running on my record. Everybody is going to be a campaign conservative. Every flyer you get is going to say, you know, that they are a conservative. So how do you define conservative? I know that that's a scale and other people will define it in different ways. But since I've been in the state Senate, I have been ranked the most conservative state senator, not just currently, but in Oklahoma history. So I have that proven record based on how I vote. But I've also had major accomplishments. Like David said, I am pro Second Amendment. I don't just have to say that. I've actually passed legislation that has expanded the gun rights of Oklahoma citizens. I'm not just trying to defensively protect it. I have proactively expanded those Second Amendment rights. Same thing on pro-life. I'm not just saying that I'm, you know, pro-life. I actually have passed substantial legislation. Years ago, I passed a piece of legislation that Governor Fallon vetoed, but I didn't give up the fight. We continued to fight. We actually got that legislation passed several years later, but now we've come through with new additional legislation. And both on protecting the lives of the unborn, but also on other things. Like last year, I passed a bill that would prohibit any government funds from cities, counties, or universities. And I specifically mentioned that, but it would prohibit any public funds from going to Planned Parenthood. Because we have universities here in the state of Oklahoma that if they could, they would be giving money to Planned Parenthood. So I have those types of accomplishments. I voted against it. Every new tax increase that was proposed during my time in the state Senate, I voted for every tax decrease. So I have lowered the taxes of the people of Oklahoma. So all these other things that people are going to say that they're going to do because they, you know, are campaigning now are things that I have already been doing and I have that proven record on it. So that's the main thing I tell people is I have that proven record. If you want somebody that you know that you can, that will stand up for you, I've done that. Because we've all voted for candidates that said the right things when they were campaigning, and then they get elected, and they immediately lose their way or sell out or maybe never truly believed it to begin with. We've all seen that happen. And so, but I've proven that I've stood strong no matter what, even under the threats of leadership, even when they took away my chairmanship, even with all these other things that they've done, I've stood strong and stayed consistent, and I've been able to successfully get things accomplished. So I'm running on my record. The shortest way that I boil it down is it's easy to talk the talk. That's why everybody does it during the campaign cycle. It's a lot harder to walk the walk, but I have done that. I've proven that I've done that. But the hardest thing of all is to fight the fight. I have done that. I've led the charge on the issues that nobody else was willing to lead the charge on. I've been on the forefront of many of these things even before it was ever popular, because I'm not doing it because it's popular. I'm doing it because it's right. So I have that proven record. And with that, I ask people for their vote on June 28th. If they want to get involved before then, volunteer, donate, any of those things, keep us in your prayers. That's obviously one of the most important things that people can do. But ultimately, it comes down to votes. And so I do ask people if they would vote for us on June 28th. So
website
is dahmforsenate.com, D-A-H-M, dahmforsenate.com. And I'm on all social media platforms. I'm still trying to get verified on True Social, but I'm on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, all those things until they shut me down.
Dahm, F-O-R, Senate?
F-O-R, yeah.
Senate.com.
D-A-H-M-F-O-R-S-E-N-A-T-E.com. Dahmforsenate.com. And on all social media, just Nathan Dahm.
Excellent.
All right. Wow. This has been good. This has been good. Thank you for giving us that time. And hopefully we've given you enough time to express your thoughts. If, who knows, we have to June, I guess, if you should want to come back. Okay. And, you know, we will, of course, open this up to your however many umpteen other candidates.
I don't have to say this because I've watched your record. You always have a positive campaign. You don't go negative. You don't go nasty. And I encourage you to continue that. I'm going to say the same thing to the others.
Yeah. Oh, no, I agree. Mm. This is the hardest race that I've ever had to be involved with, because three of you are very good friends, okay? Three of you. And I guess it's good. It's like having two teams, or three teams, let's say, that in one way you feel good about it, whichever one wins, but at the same time, you feel bad about the two that don't win. Yeah. It's kind of like that. You know what I mean? You wish, that's why I just wish one of you were on the other side, that at least two of you could win that one as well. But I think in the end, I just trust that, the best man will win. And, like I said, I think you've really handled yourself well. From where you've come so many years ago, when I told you I think you were too young, too early, to where you are now, I'm just amazed. I'm very, very impressed and blessed at seeing, especially knowing your background. And of course, you know, being an MK missionary kid, for those of you that don't know what that is, having been a missionary myself and having four MKs that I raised, but I've just seen, and I know what success, missionary kids attain. I mean, it's just something in you having that experience of experiencing the world. I don't think anybody else can equal that. I mean,
it gives you a unique perspective.
It does. It does.
And my wife's an MK too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah. MK squared. You should get, a t-shirt.
Turkey.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah. Another one. Yeah.
Yeah. So, Muslim, authoritarian inside of.
Yeah. So, yeah. Wow. Well, again, Nathan, thank you so much for joining us. And good luck on the campaign.
Thank you, guys.
And Dave, you have anything else you want to add or say?
I'm really excited. You've inspired me with your message today.
Well, thank you. And we will be back shortly with more on Fresh Black Coffee. All right, we're back. Hey, that was a great hour there. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm serious. I really mean it when I say that I've just seen the growth, the maturity in Nathan over the past 14 years or so since we first met there. And there's a lot we share in a sense in, as I said, him being a missionary kid, growing up there in Romania. I've lived over in Europe, Holland, Germany. I've toured those areas, been down Yugoslavia. It's about as far east as I got. But, yeah, it's, there's something about missionary kids that, it's just, it's a little different. Mm-hmm. You know, they get to see parts of the world and see things, Morocco. Mm-hmm. My kids, we did get into Morocco and places like that, Africa, certain places.
Keep going.
Yeah, that others, oh, you okay? That others may not see. Oh yeah, get us a little closer, huh? You may want to turn it a little to get you more in the picture.
Yeah. No, we're both in it.
Are we? Okay. There you are. There you are. There's the chair.
All right.
Okay. Anyway, yeah, there's things that kids growing up in one town just, you know, you just don't get to experience that.
Yeah.
And a lot of times it's rough. You know, there's rougher things. You don't have some of the things that other kids have. And in fact, myself, I was a Democrat. I worked for McGovern, the McGovern campaign at one time. Yes.
We were all born in sin.
Yeah. Yeah. But, and so, I think it was like, let's see, we went over in 81 mm-hmm. and I had voted for, Carter, in 80.
Mm-hmm.
And, but in the second term, of Reagan, I voted for Reagan, mm-hmm. and I had become a complete.
That's a very similar story.
With oh, really?
Me. Yes, oh, okay. I voted for Carter too.
Yeah. So, oh, hey, it's true confession time.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's just that I became a total. In fact, one of my fellow YWAMers, Youth with a Mission mm-hmm. workers, on Facebook, it's about 10 years ago, and he had been reading my. My blogs.
Mm-hmm.
And he was saying, Eddie, I'm confused. I remember you being a real Democrat when you were over here with us. And mm-hmm. I said, yeah, I was, but I mm-hmm. saw the light, you mm-hmm. know, but I had changed when I was over there because I just saw, what was going on. And I think what did it, I would see all these protests in Amsterdam, especially it was in Amsterdam, and they would have protests every week down. Big disturbances and things. And they have this thing, they call them clockers, crackers. We would say crackers, but clockers, but with a K. And what these were basically squatters. They had this big squatter movement. And they had some weird rule that if you leave a place uninhabited, mm-hmm. like if you're a property owner and you have these apartments that are vacant, somebody can actually break in and, mm-hmm. and live there. And then you can't get them out.
Wow.
It's squatters' rights.
Yeah, Florida had an issue with that.
Did they really?
Yeah, Florida law was, yeah, once they established themselves there,
yeah.
getting them out's hard.
Yeah, and so they would have these, and they'd have these big cracker riots. I mean, these protesters for their rights and everything. So anyway, and I started thinking, something's not right about this. Something's mm-hmm. weird. And then they were always protesting against America. Mm-hmm. You know, and these peace riots. And I remember getting into an argument with a guy about America and what we were doing, you know, but they were still at that time, they were still complaining about us in Vietnam. And we're talking the '80s now. Mm-hmm. Vietnam had been over for like almost mm-hmm. 20 years, you know, it was like 84 or something. And they were still complaining about us, you know, mm-hmm. I guess it was 10 years earlier when we left Vietnam, mm-hmm. but they still, and I saw, so these people just, they're bored. Mm-hmm. They just want something to complain about. And they just hate America. And they hate America for our prosperity. That's what it really was. Mm-hmm. And so it really started changing yeah. me to see this. And so I remember coming up with a thing about they wanted to ban the bomb. They wanted to ban guns.
Oh, sure.
You know, I said, well, when are you going to ban the brick?
Mm, yeah.
Because people will be beating each other with
yes.
bricks and rocks and things like this.
Yeah.
I got into a thing a while back about Australia. You know, Australia, I don't know if you know, but they have some of the most stringent gun laws mm-hmm. on earth.
Yeah. Now I mean, they do.
Yeah. yeah. And what started it, they, was there was a mass murder about, oh, I think it's about 15, 16 years ago, I think it was, where 18 people were killed. And so I started researching this. Well, it was over 3 days. It wasn't one single, the guy was in three different, the guy killed people in one place, went to another place and another place, and he kept shooting people. And nobody brings up the fact if someone had been armed at any of these places, they could have shot him and prevented it.
Yeah.
And, but then I started looking at the mass killings in Australia. That was the only shooting in 20 years.
Yeah.
They had many more people killed by explosives. Mm. And you know what the number one tool was for mass killings in Australia? Cars.
Oh, yeah.
People were running their cars into things and just running over people, killing six, eight people at a time. I mean, you can look this up. Go to just Google, you know, mass murders in Australia. And I couldn't believe how many people were being killed by cars, people driving cars and just killing people.
Yeah.
Do you know what the biggest mass murder in America was?
I think it's somebody blew up a school and a bunch of kids died.
You are with it. You know your stuff. Yeah. 1936.
Yeah.
It was in Washington. I mean, in Detroit, not Detroit. It was in Michigan. Mm-hmm. I can't remember the name. If it was Saginaw or it was a town in Michigan. Mm-hmm. And a disgruntled teacher.
Mm. I know it was a janitor.
I don't know.
Okay, somebody worked.
It was in a school, and he basically blew up, used explosives, and killed, I think it was 60 people.
Yeah. Now, see, my
students, kids, children, it was young kids. It wasn't like high school or anything. This were young kids, teachers, children, everything, blew them up.
Yeah, my great-grandfather, when he came to what is now our family homestead, Nonania, Minnesota, outside of town, had to blow up some beaver dams, you know, to make a productive farmland. And he just ordered dynamite through the, I think it was Sears Roebuck. He used to be able to just order it. And I remember as a kid playing in the old shack that used to be their little three-room home. And parents, no, up in that attic, that's where we store with what dynamite we didn't use. And it's still there. And finally, they had to call the state police. Come get this dynamite. Bring your bomb truck. Because the older it gets, the more unstable it gets. And this was 100-year-old dynamite.
Yeah, it was leaking the nitroglycerin, I bet. That's where
it had. But anyway, it used to be you could order dynamite in the catalog.
In the catalog.
And who wants to be the delivery guy? Here, toss it on their porch.
You know, I was just at the post office yesterday. Have you mailed a package lately?
Yes.
There's anything liquid, fragile.
No, you can't send shampoo anymore.
Yeah, corrosive. You know, you got to answer all these questions.
Yeah,
and you know, it's so. Funny. And they used to ship dynamite in the post. Can you imagine being a mail carrier?
Yeah,
shipping dynamite.
Can I throw something at you? I was listening to Nathan Dahm. I'm sorry.
No, I'm trying to get ready to catch.
Oh, okay.
Okay, go ahead.
I came up with a personal checklist that I'm going to determine each candidate by. Principles and effectiveness. Because there are people that you will hear that their principles seem solid, right where you're at, right the kind of thing. But then you gotta say, but could they be effective? And you could say electability might be part of that. Okay. Maybe not. And then there are people that may have principles, but they realize they're not effective. And what do? They sell out on their principles to gain some effectiveness once they're elected. And then there are people that, boy, they're effective. Oh, they can sell ice to Eskimos, but they have no principles. I wanted to throw that at you because what I heard from Nathan Dahm today is strong on both. And he's demonstrated it. He went to the Oklahoma Senate with principles, and he's kept them. By and large, I mean, a person could, you know, pick apart this or that, and he's been effective. And I think that's the reason he spent a lot of the time in his interview talking about, because that's his resume.
No, I agree. He's done an incredible job. I didn't even realize everything that he's already done. And he hasn't gotten the notoriety that some of the others have because, you know, it's funny because Mark Wain, for example, is known for his success in business. He's been an incredible businessman, okay? He took a company that was $250,000 in debt from his father.
Deceased father.
And turned it around within months, and it's been very, very successful. And he's been very successful in that, and he's done a good job in the house. Then you have T.W. Shannon, who was speaker. He's been known, he's been on Fox, News Channel. He's sitting on Greg Gutfeld on the show. You know, he's had that kind of exposure. So he's had more, I think he's been on Newsmax. So he's had more of a national exposure than even the other two.
And that would go to the effectiveness.
Well, but hold on. I'm just trying to explain the difference between these three main candidates. Then you have the also rants.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, these are the three, to me, the top three. You've got Nathan, TW, and Mark.
I would concur.
Okay. Okay. So you've got, and so this is where what you're talking about comes into play, right? You've got Nathan's effectiveness, and then you've got the others' effectiveness and exposure. And how, and the people are going to have to measure those. And it's very important that they do measure those. And they have to be measured at different, in different ways. There are different ways of having to measure those. And the number, but see, that's what bothers me so much about things today. That the average person today doesn't, I think a part of it, I don't think people know how to measure those things. That's the one thing. That's the one thing. And then secondly, I don't think they have the tools, innate tools or even external tools by which to do it. So for example, there's not a, a website or there's not a central place that has a scale, you know, where it puts, this is everything this one has done. This is everything this one has done. This was everything and so forth, right? There's not that scale. Everything is so much on appearance, right?
Yeah.
You know, oh, that TW, he's a good looking guy. You know, look at what he's wearing. Look at how he looks. Look at his hairstyle. Look at his, look at his family. He's got a beautiful family. He's got, look at Mark Wayne. He's done this. He's done this. Look at Nathan. He's done, you know what? He's done this. He does it. He's got a beautiful family. He's got a good history. He's got a good background. And you're sitting, oh my goodness. Who, you know, and then you got the guy sitting there with Jim Inhofe. You know, he's sitting on a couch or in the living room with Jim Inhofe and Jim. So I can not more highly recommend anyone than blah, 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 blah. You know, and then you got this guy over here who's been in Washington and, you know, and then people have to sit there and decide, okay, which one of these, you know, you got Rand Paul doing commercials for Nathan. You're going to have this one. You got Mark Wayne, Donald Trump in his commercials. Then you've got TW with, you know, talking about Trump and support. And so it's just, I don't know. It's tough. You know, it's really, really makes it hard.
Yeah.
And as I said, the hard thing, the really hard thing is the fact that in my case, I think all three of these guys are good guys. They're all three good. But as you said, if you take the effective scale, then you'd have to say effective in Oklahoma. In Oklahoma, for Oklahoma, you'd have to say, right now, I'd have to say Nathan Dahm wins on that scale, okay? But here's the problem. You've got Oklahoma, and then you've got the nation. How does that translate into U.S. politics, right? Mm-hmm. In other words, when he gets to Washington, is he going to become congresswoman from Georgia that is in trouble every time you turn around? You know who I'm talking
about.
Marjorie Taylor Greene. Yeah. Is Nathan going to be attacked like her? Because honestly, I agree with almost everything that she believes in. Mm-hmm. I agree with almost everything she does. Mm-hmm. The problem is I don't agree with the way she does things. Mm. Okay. I think that's her biggest problem. Her mouth is bigger than everything else.
Yeah.
Okay. So she, her ambition, her drive is maybe a little ahead of everything else.
Yeah. She's an extrovert. You know, she's that kind of, Jesse Jackson one time, Pat Buchanan said about him, the only thing that man's ever run is his mouth. And there are politicians like that, that all they've ever run was their mouth.
Right, right. Well, but she has run a business. I mean, she does. She's been a successful businesswoman. But again, yeah, if she would tone down a bit of her self, maybe she would be more effective, okay?
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with her. I mean, I agree with the things she believes in, the things she does and all that. I'm just saying it's more her. Now the difference in Nathan's not, he's not that extrovert personality, okay? Mm-hmm. But what I'm saying is, and this is what really drives me crazy. This is a good discussion we're having in retrospect, to going back over him to discuss the things he might be facing. Will he be stabbed in the back like Donald Trump by his own people? Mm-hmm. In other words, he's not going to play the game. Okay. He's not going to play the game. So will you have the others trying to keep him out of certain positions? Will you have people conspiring against him within his own party to keep him from being effective? Now, we've seen in the things we've shared that he talked about, that he has been smart enough to know the rules, to get around to where he's been able to get into positions anyway.
That's the most impressive thing about him.
That is pretty impressive.
Because, you know, I remember him talking about, you know, Mike Schultz went on to become Senate President Pro Tem. And he knew how to manipulate if that's what it takes. I want to compare him to one of his colleagues, somebody very much agreed with him, Senator Josh Burkeen. Mm-hmm. Burkeen allowed himself to be cornered by some extremists to the point where he didn't even run again. Now he's running for U.S. Congress 2nd District, the seat that Mark Wayne is vacating. But you have to be careful when you're Nathan Dahm, because you're so passionate, your principles so solid, that the real passion, energy, the grassroots can sometimes push you to places that are not smart tactics.
Exactly. And that's what I was talking about Marjorie Taylor Greene.
Yeah.
She was pushed to that point, and that mouth of hers, that large, large mouth of hers, got her in trouble, her own party is worked against her. So now Nathan, to his defense, he seems smarter, shrewder, I guess, if you will, than others.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Maybe, hopefully Josh has learned. Mm-hmm. Josh has stepped back and figured this out, how to play the game and be able to come in if he wins and do it right.
Yeah. Because I tell you, and Randy Crable sat in that chair a few weeks ago and said there, a couple weeks ago, and said, there are enough toss-up Senate seats in this election cycle that could flip it, in that if Nathan somehow didn't win this U.S. Senate race, he still has 2 more years, he could see himself as Senate pro temp. It's that close, because it's a very divided Republican caucus. And it's, Nathan has drawn a bunch of people who are sick of Greg Treat's tricks. And Nathan has a caucus, generally called the Freedom Caucus of the Oklahoma Senate. So I'm telling you, Nathan has played things tactically very well.
Right.
Very well. He just impresses me.
Yeah, sure. Now let me ask you this. So this, if he, whoever wins this seat, mm-hmm. on this side, not the one that Langford is going to
right.
run.
Right. The unexpired term.
Right. The unexpired term. It still keeps the same. It still expires here in, what, 4 years?
Right, because Inhofe won just 2 years
right.
ago, and now it's
so, coming up. So that one will expire again in 4 years mm-hmm. and then be up again. And mm-hmm. then the other one will be have another 2 years beyond that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, that's what I was thinking. So, okay.
Yeah.
All right, hey, let's move on a little bit here.
Yeah.
I've got something that's really this Disinformation Governance Board.
Yes.
Man, I never would have believed that we could get to a point where our nation would even consider something like this.
The gall.
The gall. But what it tells me is they're very, very afraid.
Oh, yeah.
They've seen the writing. And when Elon Musk, he has really frightened them. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've never seen anything like it. I've never seen anything like it. The Democrats and progressives are like roaches in a bright light.
Yeah.
They are scrambling like crazy. Sure, yeah. And I think what's happening, I think they've always planned to do this. I think the only thing different is that he's caused them now to accelerate
mm-hmm.
everything.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think they see the writing on the wall. They realize that this November election and the 2024 election are not looking good. So they are trying everything they can to put in place things
mm-hmm.
to keep themselves in power, to keep things from getting changed.
Yeah.
And it's up to you and us mm-hmm. to keep that from happening.
Yep.
Because the Ministry of Truth is what I like to call it, from 1984, the book and film 1984. For those of you that don't know, the Ministry of Truth is something George Orwell spoke about, which essentially was nothing more than a propaganda
mm-hmm.
department.
Yeah. You... In a democracy, you cannot have any government entity establishing what is truth, because they'll always say that we're always telling the truth, right?
Right.
And so you have, this is the beauty of an independent journalist industry and diversity within that journalism industry. Right. You know, because then ideas fully debated.
What's funny is the Democrats would, they keep trying to say that Elon Musk is threatening our democracy.
Oh, God.
Donald Trump is threatening democracy. Republicans are threatening democracy.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the weirdest thing.
Yeah.
We talked about it a few weeks ago that they're doing what cults have done.
Yes.
Redefining terms. They're defining democracy as what they mm-hmm. teach is democracy, what they preach, what they believe and hold is true. What they want you to believe is democracy, not what's truth.
Yeah.
Not what's really democracy. And this is where you, as citizens of the United States of America, people who grew up under democracy in a republic,
mm-hmm.
have been raised to understand as democratic, democracy, freedom of thought, freedom of speech, freedom to assemble. All of that they're trying to get rid of.
Yep.
They want to control what you read. They don't want Elon Musk to allow anybody to tell you that The Democrats are cheating. The Democrats are lying. Joe Biden is losing his mind if he has not already lost it. The Democrat Party is bad. This is bad. That's bad. Donald Trump was a good president. The economy is bad. They do not want you to be able to say that. They want you to think it's all good. It's all good. They want you to believe that everything that Jen Psaki says, oh, yes, Jen, thank you. Thank you for telling us the truth. Thank you for telling us the truth, and everything these other people say are a lie.
Yeah.
ABC, CBS, NBC, PBS, oh, it's all good. Fox, Newsmax, that's bad. That's what they want us to believe.
Yep.
And they want, now, they want us to buy this from them, and they want to control it. Now, here's what's weird. They have selected a lady, Nina Jankowicz.
Oh, yes.
Nina Jankowicz is who they are wanting to put in charge of this, okay?
Yes.
Let me tell you a little about Nina. She is to be the new spreader of and director of this bureau. And she's been a spreader of misinformation herself. She called the Biden laptop story Russian planted misinformation. How's that for truth? She planted misinformation herself. She has lied herself.
I thought she was an expert. Didn't she go to Russia?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's where she, yeah, let's look at her background. She attended Bryn Mawr College, a double major in Russian and political science. But get this. Then she went to Herzen State Pedagogical University in Russia. Oh. She went to school in Russia. She graduated there in 2011. And then she was a Fulbright fellow. Guess where? In Kiev.
Oh, wow.
In Kiev.
Ukraine.
Ukraine. Thank you. Couldn't get the word out of my mouth. She was working with the foreign ministry of Ukraine.
Now, that's under the guy, the corrupt guy that was before the current.
And who was the vice president at that time?
Oh, Joe Biden.
And what was he saying?
Oh, they're talking about how corrupt they were.
Yeah, don't you remember? Don't you remember that was when he told the guy, you drop this or we're not giving you this money? Yeah. Yeah, she's the author of two books. Oh, well, before that, Ukraine, she's also served as a disinformation fellow. So apparently she's good at disinformation.
Yes!
At the Woodrow Wilson Center. And as supervisor of the Russia and Belarus programs at the National Democratic Institute.
Yeah. Now, Woodrow Wilson is the patron saint of globalism.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So, yeah.
Right. Exactly. And then, she's written two books, How to Lose the Information War. So she's an expert in losing the information war, and How to Be a Woman Online. She's contributed to the Washington Post and New York Times.
And she's a poet. I saw a video. It made no sense, but.
Yeah, this is the person we want determining who decides what information is true and what's false. And we allow that. It's just, it's sad. I mean, it's crazy. So, this was presented. I think, I don't know if he was supposed to tell us this, but Mayorkas, but Mr. Mayorkas, let this cat out of the bag. And, head of DHS there. And, he's the one who notified us that they're allowing this. I'm trying to decide, is this even constitutional?
Yeah. Now, Mayorkas just testified before the House, and as a result of it, Jim Jordan said there will be an impeachment in the next Congress of Mayorkas.
Or there should be one before then.
Well, yeah, I know, but the, you know, is Nancy Pelosi going to call for it?
Well, that's so, true. Yeah. That's true. That's true. Yeah.
But it's a comeuppance. So yeah. By the way, heads up, there's supposed to be a Trump rally last night in Nebraska. Well, we had tornadoes all over Kansas, and it was a little too close. They've rescheduled it Sunday afternoon. There's going to be air. So just if you thought you missed it or you got over soon last night, I'm looking at changing channels. It's nowhere to be found. And like, oh, okay. Now I found out.
Okay. Yeah. Well, thank you for that.
Well, yeah, because you know what? The legacy media is not going to tell you any of that.
Yeah, really?
Yeah.
Also, so back to that deal. So here's my problem, okay, with misinformation and the whole the government wanting to do this anyway.
Yeah.
I've always had this problem. Mm-hmm. Why do we have to be treated as children? You and I, we went at it on Facebook. That's how we met on Facebook. Mm-hmm. We fought like cats and dogs for a little
while. Yes. I was trying to give you the proper information.
Exactly. And I didn't listen. I didn't listen. But I won. The truth won.
Yeah. Yeah.
The 18,000 at the Maybe Center.
No, the Maybe Stadium.
The Maybe, Maybe Center Stadium.
That's what Trump called it, so it's a stadium, don't you know? Stadium,
exactly. We need to rename it to Maybe Stadium.
Yeah.
But, no. But, I mean, come on. You know, they act like we're children and we can't decipher the truth. This is what Elon Musk is wanting to come in. He's saying he's taking over Twitter and he's saying if you're not old enough to be able to discern when somebody posts something on Twitter that this is the truth and this is not the truth, then you shouldn't be on Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
I mean, we don't need a truth bureau.
Well, right. And he said, how do you define it? Take our criminal code. If something is illegal, then that's going to be the standard Twitter uses. Okay.
And that's what it should be.
Yes, exactly. And what they're trying to do now is say, oh, that's dangerous for you to have that view on medicine. You know? So, yeah, I totally agree with that.
Yeah,
and that's where it needs to be because anything else is condescending. They're treating us like children who can't make up our minds for ourselves. We can't be trusted to vote unless they've already
told us who to vote for.
Right.
Essentially. I mean, essentially that's what it was.
Right.
And of course, that's going to eventually lead them to tell us everything. Mm-hmm. And we've seen it with our children.
Yeah.
They want us. They want to raise your children for you. They want to, the best movie, there have been several movies out. Logan's Run was a good one. Do you remember that
one? I remember that.
Logan's Run. Soylent Green was probably the ultimate, where eventually they euthanize everybody after a certain age.
And, mm-hmm.
Another real good one, well, of course, Fahrenheit. What is it, 9/11? Fahrenheit, is it 2/11 or... I can never inform
the first one, not the Michael Moore Fahrenheit 9/11.
No, no, that's Fahrenheit 9/11. Yeah, no, it's just Fahrenheit.
Yeah, I forget.
Anyway, it's the one. Yeah, it's the one where they burned all the books, and if you had books and they caught you, you were in prison. They were limiting your ability to get knowledge. There have been several of these films out there that about. You know, book Nazism. I mean, in Germany, remember they were burning all the books. They were burning books and so forth. Well, that's essentially what this is. They're not burning because we don't have books anymore. Kids don't read anymore. It's all online. They're essentially not. Yeah. They're the precog. They're pre-reading. They're not allowing you to read it at all. They're blocking what you can read. They're blocking the information you can even get. So that you don't, they don't even have to burn it anymore. Mm-hmm. That's what this is all about. It's got to stop.
I had to tell you, and I wish I had written down who it was, but there was a political debate some time back. Heard about it in Newsmax. Conservative and a liberal, and the liberal had the gall to say, the schools are better equipped and able to raise your kids than you are. And the conservative said, oh, you are. Tell me my kids' names. They couldn't tell you. Every child is unique and has a unique set of needs, a unique set of ways in which to properly and effectively educate them, communicate with them. I mean, let's face it. This is the way we are.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. No, no. I mean, that's true. Ron DeSantis is fighting this, of course.
Yes.
I mean, what's wrong with the 49 other, you know, governors? But Ron DeSantis, I mean, he's something else. I mean, this guy, I mean, he's Superman in a sense, super governor, I guess. But he says the Biden administration's creation of a disinformation bureau within the DHS is effectively a ministry of truth that is alien to our constitutional tradition. Florida rejects Biden's attempt to enforce regime-approved narratives and to stifle dissent.
Yeah.
That's exactly, I mean, just succinctly, very mm-hmm. clearly, he nails it. That's what this is. It's a regime-approved narrative to stifle any dissent.
Yeah.
I just, you know, I remember as a kid in the 60s watching news and every day hearing about Pravda and Stas, mm-hmm. the Russian media,
mm-hmm.
and how Stas and Pravda were stifling any freedom of the press. They were only writing what the government wanted them to write. That's mm-hmm. all the news the people got. It's going on right now in Russia again. The Russians, all they read and see on TV there about the war in Ukraine is what Putin wants them to hear
yes.
and wants them to know. This is what the Democrats want to hear for our country. The only difference is they only want us to know what they want us to know, which would be all Ukraine, Russia bad, Ukraine good. The Russians are saying Russia good, Ukraine bad, USA bad. Right here, it's Russia bad, Ukraine good, we good, NATO good. It's the same thing. Instead of us being a free thinking, free believing, free living nation and freedom of information, we want to drive everyone. And the sad thing is the people who were what you would call hippies, they were for freedom of thought. They're no longer for freedom of thought. Mm-hmm. It's, we want it our way. All of these idiots that are trying to keep Elon Musk from taking over Twitter and they're coming up with rules and new legislation. The government now wants to control Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's amazing.
Oh yeah. The FCC is claiming they now
should control Twitter. Yeah. Oh, really? Now you want to control them? Yeah. See, this is all, I mean, it's so clear. It's so obvious what's going on. Right. And unless we, you, me, Dave, step up and say, no, this has to stop. It's not going to stop. And I'll tell you, Dave, this is something that's starting to bug me more and more and more.
Yeah, I want to say.
Well, let me finish my thought, if you don't mind. Mm-hmm. Keep your thought, mm-hmm. please. But what really is bugging me is the church.
Mm.
You got these churches mm-hmm. that think all they have to do is deal with their, you know, how many did we convert? How many did we baptize this week? All else would be good. That's all they care about. They don't care what's going on around us.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't realize, they don't see. You know what I wrote an article a while back. I don't know if I published it or if it's called renovating your living room while the house is burning down.
Oh, yeah.
I think I told you about it.
That catchphrase you've repeated a couple of times.
Yeah, renovating your living room while the house is burning down. And that's what I say to these pastors, to these churches that are so busy trying to build their churches and their congregations while the nation is being destroyed.
Eddie, okay, Dave. These pastors have to go to conferences because there's things in the Bible that aren't sufficient. They haven't taught them in the Bible how to run sole proprietorship churches and produce better stage presentations. Because that's what a lot of the churches become today, is a bunch of sole proprietorship operations that do a wow me stage presentation. And they call that the church. And I have a problem with that. Okay. And yes, that was David at FreshBlack.coffee.com. Okay.
You know, and don't forget Sooner Politics.
Yeah, that too. So, but this is my problem with it, because the church of the first century was much different than what we've seen it become in these last
centuries. Well, that's why they died.
Yes.
So many of them. That's why they were martyred.
Well, yeah, they were effective.
Yeah, you know.
Right. Well, yeah.
That's why they die in the third, I mean, not third world, but in communist countries, in these countries, in Russia, Romania, you talk about Romania, mm-hmm. they were killing the Christians.
Mm-hmm.
Albania, they were impaling yeah. them on giant 6-7 foot
yeah.
Stakes.
Yeah, but what was God saying when he welcomed me and was going, well done, thou good and
yeah.
faithful servant?
Yeah.
Because that's our number one thing, is to be faithful to God, not to be popular amongst men.
Yeah. Put a thing on your wall, how many were baptized, how many were saved, how many were this and that.
Yeah.
You know, oh yeah.
Yeah.
But how many went out the back door? How many kids this and this, and how many this and this?
Mm.
You know, how many did we lose this week?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, anyway, I digress.
Yeah, so,
but you were going to say, I'm
yes,
sorry.
Yes, on this, you know, media, what needs to be separate. Now, the FCC was set up because we only had a finite amount of radio wave frequencies, and we needed some way to organize it. But we don't have finite websites. We don't have finite newspapers. FCC has no authority over newspapers, okay? And should have no authority over any websites, an email, or any of that. And this is the problem with mission creep. This is a bold-faced effort to suppress media that they don't approve of. And now I want to get to the other thing. Governments have, in the past, set up a government-run media. British have, BBC, ever hear of it? Canadian Broadcasting System. And they are some of the most corrupt and disinformation, especially during the Ottawa truckers protest there. The CBC was a bunch of lies. And we cannot tolerate anymore in this era. Remember when Scaramucci was, those few days he was press secretary, held up his cell phone. He said, this is a broadcasting studio. This is a TV studio. We're at the point now where we cannot justify our government paying money out to any kind of TV or radio or even newspaper and say, well, we need you, therefore we're going to fund you. I don't have a problem with NPR or PBS right. as long as they are funded by supporters. Advertise for all I care. But don't take a dime from state or federal government.
Right, right. I mean, that's what they're supposed to be.
Yeah.
I mean, actually, that's why they're always raising money.
Right.
Right, exactly. And if you are state funded, then stay state funded. Mm-hmm. Don't be pushing your little,
right.
you know, one-sided things that mm-hmm. you do. You know, that's the thing. That's the problem. We've allowed this mission creep, this mixture of where we've allowed federal funding for private advocacy, and mm-hmm. it's always to the left.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things that, see, I've always talked about this, that I've seen, it goes back to the seven mind molders, mm-hmm. but this is one thing that progressives have been much smarter than Christians, and conservatives in. Mm-hmm. Conservatives, I've talked about this, or I've written about it in the past, that when a conservative or Christians see a young person that's, let's start with the Christians. A Christian mm-hmm. gets a young person and they're very gifted. They're a great speaker. They have a good mind and so forth. What's the first thing you want to do? Oh, you need to become a youth minister.
Mm-hmm.
You want to send them to seminary,
mm-hmm.
right? And you start out as either a music leader, worship leader, or you want to become a youth pastor and so forth and on, and then you become a pastor. Mm-hmm. Well, instead of sending them to a communications school, get a communications degree, and send them into broadcasting mm-hmm. or news,
yeah,
then you take a good conservative, let's just say, not into the ministry, but a good conservative guy, what do you want to do? He wants to become a great business guy. Mm-hmm. So he goes to Wall Street or somewhere. Mm-hmm. He's going to make a bunch of money. But instead of going into government, like a Nathan Dahm, mm-hmm. or sending him into executive, some kind of media executive mm-hmm. job, a government executive job. I'll tell you where the gay movement, mm-hmm. what they've done. This is funny where they've really concentrated, and we didn't see it until probably in the last 20 years, 15, 20 years. But they've focused on getting into human resources. Mm-hmm. It used to be called personnel departments. Mm-hmm. They changed it to human resources. Mm-hmm. And as they've gone into human resources, what do they control? Hiring, firing, and promotion, mm-hmm. right? And even the military. That's why the Pentagon has all these high officers that all of a sudden we find out, oh, this is a lesbian, this is a gay, got gay generals and lesbian mm-hmm. generals all of a sudden. You wonder, how sure. the heck did, where did they come from? Well, it's because the human resource, which we call personnel,
yeah.
these people have, in the other one area that they've taken control of is military intelligence. That's mm-hmm. where, whatchamacallit? Chelsea.
Yeah.
Chelsea Manning, yeah,
okay.
was in intelligence.
Right.
So they were smart. They knew, I don't know how they did it.
Well, they set up Trojan horses. That's yeah. what those
but
are.
But I mean, I know, but as far as recruiting, right. planning, they apparently have a group that has sat back and figured this out, mm. and they know how to strategically plan.
Right.
Whereas conservatives have not figured this out, how to strategically mm. plan and place their smartest, sharpest people into these places, mm-hmm. play the game so where they can take over these places, start promoting their own
yeah.
people and take over these yeah. positions.
Because the Trump 2020 election couldn't have been stolen from him if he had won the governor's races in Pennsylvania, Michigan, Wisconsin. Now, there's a few others there, Kentucky, you know, and some others. But this is the problem, because the Trojan horse, the gatekeeper, the one in charge of who gets let in, that's really what we're hearing from what you're saying. Yeah.
Yeah, so anyway, boy, there's a lot more we could talk about.
Yeah.
But we've almost done 2 hours here today.
Yeah. By the way, a little bit of shop here. Kevin Adams has reached out, wants to come back in and talk about what happened in the David Weir.
Yeah. By the way, yeah, just to for those of you that haven't heard or may not know, David Weir was found guilty, first degree murder, mm-hmm. and been sentenced to death.
Now, they kicked two jurors off. And then the new jurors came in, agreed, and they sentenced him to death.
My opinion is there are several appealable.
Huge appeals.
Arguments that being
yeah.
made.
Yeah, and I.
We haven't spoken to Kevin Adams, by the way. This is just from.
Yes, my, other bloggers have reached out to me and say, hey, Kevin wants in. I said, yeah, tell him we've got Nathan yeah. Dahm this Saturday, but we're going to try to fit him in somehow.
Yeah.
So, and I think it's important because you can only present the defense in a criminal case that the judge allows you to, and Kevin's going to speak to that.
Right.
Yeah.
By the way, Kevin is not allowed to present the appeal. I mean, he's not allowed to appeal the death penalty. He's not allowed to take that on, I found out.
If you,
for some reason.
Yeah. Unless there is a technical or procedural thing, such as we found out, even the judge's instructions to the jury sometimes.
Well, no, I think he can appeal the actual case.
Yes.
But he can't argue on the death penalty, the sentencing part.
Right. Now,
someone else has to argue that part, but he can.
Okay. But they basically gave him either not guilty or first degree murder. First degree murder by statute has to be premeditated. If they can prove in appeal that, oh yes, he planned to kill them all along, this was not spur of the moment, act of passion or, you know, thing like that. So by vacating at least the first degree, getting it at least turned to second degree or retried, that automatically then rescinds the death penalty.
Right.
Yeah. So we got that. Stitt is, also, he's gotten second thoughts about some of the, or at least one of the paroles. Those of us who've been around Oklahoma enough to know about the famous crossbow murder in the 80s. A former cop murdered a woman using a poison tip arrow. And Stitt evidently was going to allow parole for a life sentence. And now he's backed off. And that David, Stephen Kutzweiler evidently changed his mind. And I, Eddie, you've heard me say this before. You've got to, if you're governor, you got to show how somehow you have more insight than the jury that convicted him. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And well, and also what this shows, which doesn't come out in some of these ads against the governor, that this leniency to allow parole for this guy, it was the parole board. The parole board makes these decisions and then the governor signs off on it. I think one thing these ads have done for the governor is told him, I better start reading these pardons and these paroles a little bit more closely than, you know, than I had.
Right. And maybe ask the DA's office who handled right. the case, bring your records here.
Right.
Tell us what you think.
Right.
But I wish they could call in some of the jurors.
Yeah. Also, here's another thing though, on those earlier ones that we're seeing the ads about. I think a big part of those though also is the fact that some of those, like he's presented with 200 of these things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it wasn't just
right.
this one thing here, sign this, you know, they bring him 200 of these things and, you know, and it might be mixed in with this. So that's a, you know, I don't know exactly, but I have a suspicion that some of these, I think, were probably given to him. In a bulk thing. So
there were, I think he commuted 500 women, I think as clemency, 500 of them in one day.
Right. The ads we don't see are some of the ones that probably never should have been given the sentences they were. See,
right.
that's the sad thing that we don't see any ads for. In fact, that's something that should happen. Like the one where Trump gave the pardon to the lady. Remember the one? Mm-hmm. I think she was in Georgia.
Yeah.
She just happened to be delivering drugs for someone and then they gave her like life in prison.
Yes.
I mean, it was like ridiculous. She spent, I think, 20 years in jail in prison and he let her out. Things like that.
Yeah.
We never hear about this. I remember, what was her name? The one Indian, young lady here that Mary Fallon finally let out. I think she had, it was like less than an ounce of marijuana and they gave her like 10 years in prison for this, like, you know, 1 ounce of marijuana or something.
Yeah, simple possession, and each conviction was double the sentence. And I talked to several people who later went and got their card because they're dealing with something that they said, no, it's an effective treatment for a psychological or other condition. But they said, if we didn't have this, I was facing 20 years for taking my medicine.
Yeah, I think it was Spotted Crow.
Yes, I remember
Rebecca,
that.
Rebecca, I think it was Rebecca Spotted Crow or something.
Yeah.
And she had kids. She had these young children.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, Pat and I, it was one of our big things. We were like at least once a month, we would bring up Rebecca Spotted Crow, you know.
Yeah.
It was just ridiculous. First of all, that a jury or whoever put her in jail, that even put her in jail.
Yeah.
Come on. You gotta be
kidding. So, 2018, a bunch of conservatives lost re-election and we also passed medical marijuana. And Rhonda Vilmont Smith, Tulsa 912, she said, you know what? We're going to take a bunch of these guys out to dinner. You want to come with? You know, come. So I did, and I'm sitting next to him. Mike Ritz, Chuck Strom, Sean Roberts was there. There were some others. And, you know, a bunch of them were adamant against 788. And I said, when was it that we passed the law that allowed for CBD oil? And Chuck Strom said, that was the first thing I voted on when I got elected 2000. So it's 2015. Now this is in 18 or 19, early 19. I said, so that took effect just over 3 years ago. What you're telling me is 3 years ago, if a mother had a bottle of CBD oil in her purse, it was 5 years in prison that she's facing. I said, see how far we've come? And CBD oil is not in any way psychoactive, right? You know, it's now plenty of people use it as a sleep aid.
Yeah.
So we've come a long way in this. And I know, Eddie, you and I are not in the same place on a lot of this. Oh, that's another person who wants to come in. The author 788 has two state questions coming up. And now it probably will be later this summer or something, but Chip Paul, who's a big Trump Republican, and he says, we got two things. We want to fix some legislation, and then we want to put out the casual use
option. Are we going to be like Elon Musk on his thing where we're...
Oh, God, yeah. No, you smoke a cigar. He later found out it was laced with some marijuana. Yes. But he was...
Hey, speaking of in closing, District 2...
Mm-hmm.
The new, congressional race down there.
Yes.
That's an interesting, there are a lot of people running down there.
A lot of good names.
That's what I was going to say. That's another one that, I look at these names and I know several of the guys and mm-hmm. they're all good guys and I'm thinking, great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, Josh Brkeen.
Yeah, Josh.
I mentioned him. John Bennett. David Derby.
David Derby.
You know, very conservative guy who'd been in the legislature right. for some time, a doctor, I believe. Gosh, help me out. I know there's some others. Dustin Roberts, I believe. So, yeah, you've got six former legislators.
Yeah.
Six. Running for that.
Yeah, yeah.
And then there's a total of 14.
Yeah, I'm glad I don't live in that district, so it's
now, helpful. One of Nathan Dahm's campaign leaders, I'd say, who used to work for Ron Paul's campaign in 12, called me up the other day and he told me, hey, here's the strategy we're looking at. And it's a viable strategy, but the only thing I'll say about it is our strategy is number one, get in the runoff. Only two names get in the runoff. And that's the thing you're going to see in Nathan's race, you know, is that also in that second district. Get in the runoff.
Right.
Right. You know, how did Stitt become governor? He eked out getting the runoff with the last 1% coming in. He barely beat out the sitting lieutenant governor. Yep. Yeah, Todd Lamb.
Yep.
So it is, that's part of it. There's three races. First thing, win the primary, get in the runoff. Second, win the runoff. Third, win the general.
Yep. All right, everybody. That's going to be about it. Or what did Porky Pig you say? Yip, 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 yip. That's all, folks. Oh, there's that music, Dave.
Yeah.
Hey, everybody. Hey, this was really fun.
Yep.
We got a lot in today. Almost 2 hours. We thank Nathan Dahm for joining us today. We'll let you know what's going to come up next week. Hopefully, it's as good a show as today.
We have invitations out, right?
Yes.
For others.
So we'll let you know.
Yep.
Have a great week, everyone. God bless.